Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2024. And a welcome to the meeting Emma Harper, MSP, who's substituting for Karen Adam this morning. Before we begin, can I remind anyone using electronic devices to please switch them to silent. Our first item of business today is consideration of the 2024-25 Scottish Budget. And I welcome Mary Gujan, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Islands, Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands. And our officials, George Burgess, the Director of Agriculture and Rural Economy, Erica Clarkson, the Head of Islands Policy, and Karen Morley, Head of Finance in the Agriculture and Rural Economy. We've also got David Sonori, who is the Director of Marine from the Scottish Government. I would like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convener, and to the committee members also for inviting me to address the committee today. When I attended the pre-budget session in September, I set out the priorities of my portfolio, and I'm pleased to come back to outline how the 24-25 Scottish Budget, which had been presented by the Deputy First Minister to Parliament in December, will help to deliver on those priorities within the wider context of this government's priorities. Now, this budget is, of course, set in very turbulent circumstances. The global level, the impacts of inflation, we've seen war in Ukraine, and the after effects of the pandemic, of course, continue to create instability. In the UK, the combined effects of Brexit and some of the disastrous Westminster policies mean that we're uniquely vulnerable to these internal shocks. Those Brexit impacts continue to harm Scotland's rural and island businesses and communities and create new challenges every year for the Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands portfolio to respond to. Against that background, the decisions we've taken in this budget are driven by our values and prioritise our three missions, and we have chosen a progressive path to invest in our people, our economy and our public services. Now, where we can, we've taken action to prioritise support to the most vulnerable in our communities, to attract investment and to support a growing sustainable economy and address the nature and climate emergencies. And my priorities within that are clear. The budgets allocated to my portfolio will continue to make a vital difference to our rural, coastal and islands economy. As I did in the last financial year, I will prioritise the direct cash injection of over £600 million that my portfolio makes into the economy for rural, agriculture, marine and island communities. The Scottish Government is now providing the most generous package of direct support for farmers and crofters anywhere in the UK. We're also committed to getting money to people and businesses as early as we can every year to help them meet ongoing inflationary and cost of living pressures. In 2023, the first tranche of direct payments were made in September, earlier than the previous year, and exceeded forecasts by paying nearly £300 million in basic payments in the first 3 weeks. We will continue our critical work with the agricultural sector to co-develop and deliver on the agricultural vision, investing to help Scotland become that global leader in sustainable and regenerative agriculture. We've also committed to deliver agri-environment investment as part of an overall budget of around £30 million to support biodiversity. My portfolio, of course, has expanded to include responsibility for peatland and forestry, and we're maintaining our record world-leading investment in peatland, and investment in new woodland creation planting will continue to contribute to our climate change targets and net zero ambitions. By maintaining the £14 million for Marine Fund Scotland, we acknowledge the vital role that our seas play in supporting the economy and coastal communities through fishing and aquaculture, as well as supporting that activity to improve and restore the marine environment. Our commitment to supporting the ambitions for our islands also remains strong, with an investment of £6.7 million, and that's an increase from the Resource and Capital Spending Review, which was published in May of 2022, with £4.3 million now allocated in capital. Members of the committee have rightly taken a keen interest in the ring-fenced money due to return to the portfolio. I therefore welcome the return of the first tranche of £50 million of this funding in the 24-25 budget. In the draft budget, this funding is allocated as resource funding, but it's capital priorities across the portfolio where the greatest need exists. So I'm therefore glad to have received the Deputy First Minister's agreement in recent days that the portfolio will instead receive that £50 million as capital funding. It will fund vital unfunded capital priorities within the portfolio, which will provide that really vital support to our rural communities, including Agri-Environment Climate Scheme, Agricultural Transformation Fund and Crofting Grants. Convener, this government will do what we can with all that we have to support our priorities in rural industries and sectors through this and other portfolios. But the biggest challenge we face is the ongoing failure of the UK government to at least match fund pre-Brexit levels of funding from the EU, nor to provide that multi-annual funding framework which would allow us to take a longer-term view to some investments. And of course, we have no sense of what the funding future holds from the current or any future Westminster government. I know that, of course, you will want to scrutinise carefully our budget plans, but I would ask again that the committee might resolve to work with government to support our efforts to secure the future rural funding certainty that Scotland needs and which we very much deserve. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You've tried to put a positive slant on this, but this is a disaster. You sit around the Cabinet and lobby, I presume, for funding for the agriculture sector, but you've failed. We've got a 9.3% reduction in the agri budget, which is the biggest reduction of any portfolios, which is astounding given that agriculture is expected to deliver on biodiversity loss and climate change. So where's it all gone wrong?
I would disagree with you in a certain respect, Convener. I don't think there is much about putting a positive spin on things. The fact is we've had one of the worst settlements that we've seen since devolution. We've seen the capital funding we receive. Well, when we were members of the EU, we would receive a mixture of resource and capital funding. Now we are only getting replacement funding through as resource. So our capital resource has been falling. As a whole, we are seeing our capital resource fall by around 10%. And what we have seen in terms of the overall settlement to the Scottish Government is a real-term cut into the budget of 1.2%. I don't think you will find any Cabinet Secretary appearing in front of a committee giving evidence on their budget and ultimately being happy about the settlement that we've got. I don't think the Scottish Government is as a whole. It's a very difficult settlement. We've all had to take difficult decisions and make very difficult choices within that, which of course is why I'm here to answer and address the committee today. One thing that I am pleased that we have been able to do is protect that funding where I think it is needed most. When you look at the direct payments that we have, the funding that goes directly to our farmers, our crofters and our land managers, we have been able to protect those levels of funding. And I know that that cash injection is so vital for our rural communities as well. But I think if you look at our wider investments across the piece, where in some areas that funding has increased, when you look at the funding that we're providing in terms of our food and drink industry, what we are providing in terms of community-led local development, all these different areas where we've kept and maintained vital funding streams. I think all of that shows where our priorities have been and how we are still continuing to invest in our rural, coastal and island communities, and also maintaining important funds, as I mentioned in my opening remarks there, such as the Marine Fund Scotland.
I don't see anywhere in the agriculture budget where there's been an increase. It's a decrease right across the board. There's nothing increased. What I'm interested in is, so my understanding is there was £620 million came from the UK government ring-fence money, of which there was, there or thereabouts, £595 million plus £25.7 million BEW money, and the Scottish Government topped that up, if you like, given a total budget of around £680 million. Has the UK Government contribution, which is ring-fenced, decreased?
What do you mean in terms of the funding that they've provided us on the basis of last year? Uh-huh. It's been at the same level as last year.
So we've had that at the same level of funding for the last 5 years?
No, we haven't had the same level of funding from the last 5 years. It was the same as the previous year, but I believe in the year before that, it was actually less. But I don't know, Karen, if you have further information on that.
Yes, so the settlement... Sorry, do I need to press the... The ring-fence funding from Treasury was for a three-year settlement figure, and 24-25 is the last of the years, and the total for that was £620 million.
So it's, of the 620 million, that's ring-fenced. Yes. Has that budget decreased this year? So when the Scottish Government, it hasn't decreased. So any reduction in the budget as a result of the Scottish Government putting less into the agri-pot, is that right?
It would be less funding for our sector. Yeah, but you're right in terms of the UK Government has provided the same level of funding last financial year and this financial year.
So when we see real-term cuts of 18.3% in Pillar 1, 41% reduction in Agricultural Transformation Fund, 22.7% business development and so on, that all is a result of the Scottish Government contributing less to the agricultural pot, not the UK Government's agricultural settlement being reduced.
Well, by keeping the same level, though, that is a real terms cut.
What percentage is that? Did you say it was 1.4% real term?
No, the overall, in terms of the overall settlement to the Scottish Government, the real terms cut is 1.2%.
OK, what's the real terms cut in the budget that the UK Government provides? So what's the real terms cut in the £620 million that the UK Government provides?
Well, I'm not going to try and do the maths in my head, but if it's flat in cash terms, if we apply RPI or CPI to that, that would give you the real terms cut.
Yeah, but what I'm trying to work out is that the cut to the budget in real terms is 9.3%, but most of that cut comes from the top-up, if you like, that the Scottish Government have made in the past, not a reduction in the UK budget. Is that correct?
Well, again, ultimately, what we are getting from the UK Government equates to a real terms cut to our budget. The vast majority of our budget used to be, obviously, come from when we were members of the EU. So we are largely dependent on that as making up the vast majority of our funding. So, of course, that has a wider impact, as well as our own funding. I mean, it comes back to my opening comments and where we were at the start in relation to settlements right across the piece, where we are facing very difficult budget choices and difficult decisions have to be made. But all of that is exacerbated by the fact that we have the lack of clarity and no certainty on what we're receiving in future, as well as the fact that we are receiving a flat settlement from the UK Government.
Uh-huh. But we're looking at this budget, not future budgets. We'll probably deal with that when we look at the Agriculture Bill. What I was trying to work out is we've seen a dramatic cut in the agriculture budget, but that's all come from, or the majority of that has actually come from, the Scottish Government's priorities, not a cut, a dramatic cut in the UK budget, which has been the same for the last 3 years, apart from then the £27 million increase in BEW after the BEW review. That was the point I was trying to make. Maybe that's something you can come back to us with. What I'm interested in is the Pillar 1 payments are really important because they support beef and sheep, fruit and veg producers. There has been a 18.3% cut in that, and it's suggested it reflecting forecast demands. Can you explain exactly what the reduction relating to reflecting forecast demand actually means?
I'd be happy to outline that. So, as you say, the other Pillar 1 funds, exactly as you've said, we have the voluntary coupled support, so we have the beef scheme and the sheep scheme within that. We also have the fruit and veg aid scheme within that as well. I want to be absolutely clear that those budgets remain unchanged. They have not been cut. So we have £48 million, which is allocated to the voluntary coupled support, and £2.7 million, which relates to the fruit and veg aid scheme. So the element of that budget which has been reduced is what previously had been the Common Market Organisation. That budget line covered a number of different things. So that looked at we had the school milk scheme as part of that. It looked at public intervention and private storage age schemes. To give you an example of those two schemes that I've mentioned, though, within that CMO budget line, first of all, the school milk was a budget that we transferred to education, but that is now funded directly by education, and local authorities, I think, charge that to them. We have only used once the private storage aid scheme, and that was in relation to pig meat during COVID. So
interrupt, but that's not Pillar 1 payments?
This is other Pillar 1 payments.
All right, beg your pardon.
Yeah, so that's where I'm just defining what falls within that, that overall budget line, and to be clear on where any movement has been. So the Common Market Organisation line, I think, had £9 million against it. That fund went largely, well, it was unspent, apart from those specific examples that I've talked about. So that is where it was felt that the resources, rather than having a budget line against funding that hadn't been getting utilised, we were better to reallocate that to other areas where the funding could be spent. So that's why the other Pillar 1 scheme looks like there has been a reduction.
Okay, thank you. I've got supplementaries from Rachel Hamilton, Ariane Burgess and Alistair Allen. Rachel.
Morning, Cabinet Secretary. Can I just get some clarification on the previous questions that the convener was asking? You say that the UK has cut the capital budget and that they're to blame for the cuts that you've made within the rural budget. However, £65 million in total has been cut from the rural affairs budget, but the capital funding for all the portfolios that include health, justice and education have seen cash increases to their capital budgets. So how did you stick up for farmers in the Cabinet meetings around the budget, if all of that money saw an increase in capital budgets to those portfolios?
But again, you're not seeing that right across the piece as well. I mean, there is no getting around how difficult the decisions right across the piece have been with this.
What you're saying right across the piece, why did health, justice and education get an increase to their capital budgets, and the farmers, who maybe you would agree with me that they do provide Scotland with a public service?
Absolutely.
Why did that see a £65 million cut when other portfolios didn't and they saw an increase?
As I said in one of my previous responses, part of the issue in relation to the funding that we get from the UK government is that it does not come through as a mix of resource and capital as it used to previously. So therefore, we have had a fall in capital allocation throughout that time. Now, together with all my colleagues, of course, my job in Cabinet and within the Scottish Government is to represent the needs of farmers, crofters and land managers and of rural Scotland, and to really ensure that we are getting the best possible support and prioritising that as best we can. And I believe with the package that we've got, the capital settlement has been difficult, and there difficult decisions have been made in this portfolio and other areas as well. Now, you highlight some of the portfolios in government where there has been an increase. That's not the case right across government, where there have been cuts to capital budgets in other areas, which have been very significant. And in my portfolio in particular, it has been very difficult. I think when you look at the woodland grant schemes in particular, where we have seen quite a significant shortfall in the capital that's required to deliver on that. It is a very disappointing settlement as a whole. It's my job to try and do what I can with the funding allocations that we have and to ultimately fight that corner. We have made really difficult decisions, but I do believe with the budget that we have, the fact that we've been able to secure that resource to capital switch, which then enables us to do that bit more with the capital funding in what were previously unfunded priorities within the portfolio, I believe that we are delivering on that as best we can within the settlement that we've got.
Well, thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that positive spin from the Scottish Government, but you have not increased the capital budget in this portfolio. It's been cut by £65 million and the other portfolios have seen an increase. So I just don't get the spin on this, but it just seems as though farmers have been failed and they are the scapegoats of this budget.
Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'm concerned about the payments to fruit and veg producer organisations. And as we've discussed, horticulture provides more food per hectare than any other forms of farming and crofting. And it'll be critical to have a healthy horticultural sector in order to achieve Scottish Government's agricultural vision. And I just would like to hear from you what your plans are in terms of the payments towards the fruit and veg producers organisations.
I mean, as I say, within that and with the other Pillar 1 payments, that's where we have the £2.7 million, which goes to the producer organisations, which supports our fruit and veg sector. So I completely understand the concern that you've outlined. But again, I think that that's where that has been identified as a key priority and where we have been able to meet the needs of those programmes and secure that funding for the interim while we look to transition to what future support may look like as well. So that's where that £2.7 million is critical.
Thanks very much.
A fixed budget, so it's probably a sterile debate or entering into a sterile debate to ask, as some have, about why you didn't argue for more from health to go into agriculture, given that there are no doubt, as we speak, opposition members on another committee asking why more was not argued for to be taken from agriculture to go into health. So instead I'm going to ask about, I think you alluded to the issue of long-term certainty and how there's less long-term certainty in the environment ahead. So what is the impact of that on budgeting decisions in agriculture?
Well, it is really difficult going forward because this is the last year in which we have any clarity on a settlement and what that's going to look like. So from 25-26 onwards, we do not know what that's going to look like. We've tried to engage in those discussions with the UK government. It has proven very difficult. I think we've raised it on numerous occasions with the various secretaries of state in DEFRA. And that was on the basis that there had been a commitment to discuss the intra-UK allocations of funding support, but as yet those discussions and the offer of those discussions hasn't been taken up. I've been in touch with the new Secretary of State, Steve Barclay, on a number of occasions so far. We've yet to receive a response to the correspondence that we've issued in relation to, we're essentially trying to reset the relationship so that we can have a positive discussion about this going forward, but that's still to take place.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I just go back? Can I just clarify what the total agriculture budget is at the moment?
Do you mean for the
whole... For the agricultural portfolio. So, you know,
so
going
for
back
the portfolio...
to my original question about the total funding being around £680 million, what is it now? What figure are you working with?
Well, when you look at the total for over the coming financial year for... Well, for agricultural support and the related services within that, that's £705 million. Then you have the rural services budget on top of that, which is £59 million. And then if you're just looking at the rural affairs and islands element of the portfolio on that total budget, it's £864.6 million.
Okay.
And that's including, that's resource and capital.
Thank you. You'll no doubt have seen that former NFU President Jim Walker was particularly scathing of the budget, given that he'd hoped that we would be looking at nutritional management plans, biodiversity audits and plans, animal health and welfare plans and so on the premise that there would be additional funding for them to be implemented and that farm businesses would have a clear idea of what was expected of them. He's now suggesting that there is no funding, and in no shape or form will that be belatedly proposed now. Not a chance, he said. That's a quote. They were heading for a cliff edge, beaten by sticks, unless, you know, and where's the carrot? So where is the carrot? You know, when we're expecting farmers looking forward into the new agriculture bill, a whole range of new policies are going to have to implement to reach our carbon targets, our biodiversity targets. So where is the funding to give them reassurance that they'll be supported in delivering those targets?
First of all, I just want to clarify that the funding for that does exist. So we are still continuing to fund the animal health and welfare plans, the carbon audits, soil testing within the National Test Programme. There's £12 million of funding allocated towards that for the coming financial year.
But it's very little, isn't it?
Well, it's up against the forecast spend, and I believe that that still allows us to increase the uptake from where we are at the moment. I know that when I was at the committee last year, we were looking at very low figures in terms at that time of the number of people that had undertaken carbon audits and soil tests. Now, we did see that jump up towards the end of the claim period, which was towards the end of February last year, and we have seen an increased uptake in relation to that as well. So I would say that we have ensured that what we have within the budget can meet the current level that we're seeing, but also that there is that capacity there for uptake within those schemes as well. But I would want to reiterate that the support for that is still there, and I would still very much encourage farmers and crofters to take that up.
OK, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to ask a question about the Agricultural Transformation Fund. It's received a further cut and is now allocated £3 million in resource funding rather than the £5 million in capital funding. And I'd be interested to understand the reason for the reduction and then also the thinking behind moving it from capital to resource and what the funding will be spent on.
I would just want to be clear on that one, and I know that this will have been updated since the committee has seen the budget papers, but when I talked about the £15 million that we've been able to agree with the Deputy First Minister to switch from resource to capital, that is funding which we have been able to move from resource to capital. So it is still £3 million, but it's now a capital fund rather than resource, since that's where the greatest need was. So that's, I think, why having that agreement to switch that funding has been so important. In terms of the Agricultural Transformation Fund, so over the course of the past couple of years, when that we first used that, it was £5 million over the course of 2022 to 23. That was through the Sustainable Capital Agricultural Grant Scheme at that time, and it was used for more efficient slurry spreading equipment, and really to prioritise that spending on slurry given the water environment regulations that had been introduced and the requirements that farmers were being expected to meet within that. So we felt that it should be prioritised in relation to that. However, with a £5 million fund, well, we did have, I think, initially £4.6 million of that committed to, the actual spend in the end was around £3 million. Over the course of last year, with the Agricultural Transformation Fund, we had another pot of £5 million available. The spend, and that was channelled through AICS, looking at slurry storage and focusing on that, and around, I think it was just over £2 million was spent over that budget. So while it is a reduction, it's against what we think we can actually spend within that fund and what the actual spend has been over the course of the past couple of years too.
So just for a bit more information, why the move from why have you taken it from capital and put it into resource? I mean, I understand the overall envelope has moved, but why is it better to have it in resource for what you're trying to achieve?
Oh, so I would say that's why we needed it within the capital, so that we could ultimately, if we wanted to fund similar items as what we had done in previous years, we would need that funding to be capital rather than resource.
Moved it previously into capital to do the slurry work, and now you're bringing it back into resource. And then what do you anticipate it being spent on now while it's in resource?
Oh, sorry, I know that the way it's set out, and again, given the announcements that I'm making today, it does seem like it is quite a confusing picture. But the Agricultural Transformation Fund had been capital over the course of the past few financial years. It was as resource this year because of the significant constraints on the capital budget that we've seen. But again, with the £15 million being returned and the agreement to switch that to capital, that's why that has moved from the resource line into the capital budget.
So you're just using, you've got the money in a different budget, but you're spending it on the same thing.
And switch that way.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks.
Can I ask a very brief technical question? So the regulations are going to require 22 weeks storage. Will there be any restrictions on claiming through the AICS budget? So farmers who have previously claimed for slurry storage, whatever, will they be excluded, or will they be included in future schemes now that the requirements have increased?
Sorry, I think George wants to come in up.
Yes, thanks, Convener. I believe you have a written question on this subject at the moment, and an answer will be coming forward. That rule about claimants only being able to get funding once has been in place for a long time. And to explain the thinking behind it is that it allowed farmers and landowners to get their business into a compliant position. If they then changed their business, by taking on more livestock or by buying another property, such that moved them out of compliance, that was something that they should be aware of at the time. So effectively, it was a rule to try and make sure that the benefit was spread around as many recipients as possible. we're still developing the rules for the scheme going forward. But as I say, that has been a rule for a considerable period of time. I'm certainly aware of one case in convener in your constituency where this has meant that farmers have felt it at a disadvantage as they hadn't realised that at the point that they took on additional property.
That's helpful. So you're suggesting that farmers increase their business, they get one bite at the cherry and they've got a budget for an increase in cattle or whatever. However, if the regulations change to 22 weeks and farmers are then not compliant, surely the grant would be available for them to then become compliant when those regulations increased, if you like, to the 22 weeks storage.
I think your point that if the goalposts change in that way in terms of what is compliant, that's a very reasonable point. As I say, the rules are still being developed for the future scheme.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Rachel Hamilton, I beg your pardon. My apologies, Kate. Kate Forbes is remote, and I didn't see you waving. Could you come in now, Kate, please?
Thank you very much, and no problem at all, convener, and good to see you, Cabinet Secretary. It was to go back just briefly to the convener's question to which you responded, that the budget is £864 million for rural and islands. Can you just clarify, how does that compare in cash terms to last year? Because I assume that one of the reasons why this is such a challenging budget in rural affairs, as it is for everywhere, is because of the inflationary environment, which is neither farmers' fault nor the Scottish Government's fault. Question one, and a mini supplementary to that one, what percentage, roughly, is the budget going directly to farmers in terms of cash in their pocket? And do you think that compares well to elsewhere in the UK?
Firstly, just to outline in cash terms what that equates to. So if you were to look at the last financial year we had, it was 905.741 million was the total amount of funding that we had. Over the course of this financial year, it's 864.618. In relation to that, I don't know if that answers your question. In relation to the payments that are going directly to farmers and crofters, obviously we have the direct payments within that, which totals 474.7 million. But then, of course, so that's in relation to Pillar 1. But then we also have the Pillar 2. And so within that, we have the LFAS funding, which equates to 65.5 million as well, which is unchanged from the previous year. So in relation to those direct payments, obviously we have a number of other schemes which will contribute to that. We have the crofting agricultural grant schemes too, but in terms of the overall payments, I hope that answers your question and the information that you were looking for.
Thank you.
Oh, sorry, I think George wanted to come in and add information.
Perhaps just to provide a bit of further, in the published budget document on the basic payments scheme, so last year, 282 million, this year to come, 282 million. So that is being kept level. You'll be aware that in other parts of the UK, basic payments like that have not been preserved. In England in particular, basic payments are on quite a steep downward taper, and any money for farmers has to be through new schemes like the Sustainable Farming Incentive.
Thank you.
I think I've got a supplement from Jim Fairley.
Thank you, convener. You touched on something that's of great interest to me there, Cabinet Secretary, is the £65 million for LFAs. I presume that is something that you are aiming to continue, because we've seen upland farms in south of the border with a 37% cut in their support payments, and their NFU down there are looking at a catastrophic decline in the way farmers can be supported in England and Wales. I presume, as a former hill farmer, that's the direction of travel the government would look to stay in to continue to support hill farming.
Yes, you're absolutely right, and I recognise how vital that support is. So that's why we've maintained that funding over the course of the current financial year as well. I obviously no doubt that the committee will be aware of the information that we've published about the future route map for support as well and how that looks going forward. So, of course, we're still continuing and maintaining that commitment to support the LFA funding until such time as we transition to new parts of the framework, of the future framework in itself. I also met with the LFA committee within NFUS fairly recently. That was just before the recess, to obviously hear their thoughts on future support. And I understand from my own visits, visiting farmers and crofters across the country, just how important that the LFA and the support that we provide for that is. So that's why, of course, that has been a priority within the funding and that we've been able to maintain that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Convener. So we know that with the Future Agriculture Bill that the Scottish Government are planning to introduce enhanced conditionality to support biodiversity gain and to also look towards a low-carbon approach to farming. However, you mentioned the agriculture reform budget, which was cut significantly, and also we seem to have information in this committee that it was because of lower than expected uptake in previous years, which you have just mentioned. But why cut the budget if you're trying to move those farmers who aren't currently soil testing or doing carbon audits? Why not support those people to get up to speed so that they can be ready for the next demands that you will be making of them in terms of enhanced conditionality? Why cut that budget? Why not just promote that ability for them to improve uptake?
First of all, I would say that it's not a case of either or. I think we were talking specifically about the Agricultural Transformation Fund, which more accurately reflects the actual budget spend that we've had over previous years. But ideally, with that budget, I mean, to be honest, I think it's within everyone's best interest for us to be utilising all money and budgets that we have available to us. You know, I've talked about just how difficult the capital situation has been, so that's where it has been very difficult in this budget settlement, trying to prioritise which schemes are funded and what level of funding they should receive. So, of course, with the Agricultural Transformation Programme, it was felt that that would still cover, and it's more funding than what we were able to spend last year. But in terms of the improving uptake and how we can go about doing that, that is something that we are really trying hard to do, in particular with the National Test Programme. You talked about the carbon audits and soil tests. We also have the animal health and welfare plans available. We want to see that support, the uptake of that support increase going forward, because it is there, and again, it's within everyone's best interest for that funding to be fully utilised, and we are trying to incentivise that and do as much as possible in that regard. We really try to step up our communications over the course of the past year, whether that was through email communications that we send out. It was also about increasing the physical presence that we have in a lot of areas, so whether that was various agricultural shows, marts, so that we had a physical presence there where people could find out about the support that was available, as well as discussing the route map and all the other information that we've published, because I do think that there needs to be greater awareness raising of that. And I think when I was at the committee last year as well, where, you know, I did genuinely ask, I think if there are any means of communication we're not using or any ways that you think we could be communicating better, more than happy to hear those suggestions as to what more we can do, because we want to see that uptake of these schemes. And I think with the budget that we have aligned for the National Test Programme, we do still have that ability to ensure that, well, to allow for increased demand and uptake on the schemes that we're funding so far.
I disagree, because it's a percentage change of negative 40%. But on the 2021-22 budget, there was allocated £51.3 million for the National Test Programme. How much of that wasn't spent, and how has that been reallocated?
Well, that's where some of that has been, well, it's been reduced this year in terms of our forecast spend. So there had been initially £20 million allocated against that, and we have £12 million allocated in relation to that for the coming year as well. I think over the course of the last financial year, the funding hadn't been fully utilised. I don't know if, Karen, you have the information of the exact figure.
I'll find it for you.
Information
2021-22, and I just want to know.
No, that oh, sorry, just to clarify, it's over the 3 years.
Yeah,
yes.
3 years. I don't know where the 20 million is coming from, but that was 23-24, that was last year. But it's down to 12 million now. And on this specific subject, the development support budget was cut entirely. What was that for, and what would be the impact of that cut?
The development support is really just for the whole modernisation programme within the agricultural reform programme as well. And I think that was the capital element of the funding that we'd been looking at, which I think was sitting at around £10 million. So that had been initially a line that was looking at the modernisation costs. So what we and potentially earmarking monies for IT systems going forward. But what we're doing as part of the agricultural reform programme is continuing to assess what those needs might be going forward and still developing the case for that. Oh, sorry, George, I don't know if you had further information.
Yes, I mean, essentially that was money to add to modernise, change the IT system that we use within the Scottish Government. We're now looking to make the best use of the existing IT infrastructure that we have, making changes where necessary. But, you know, as the Cabinet Secretary is saying, this is essentially prioritising the money that is going out the door to farmers, crofters, landowners, rather than that money being spent in-house on our own systems.
How much of that £10.8 million was spent on upgrading your IT system?
In the last year, a relatively small proportion.
How much will you need for future to deliver future agricultural support for an IT system to put into the budget?
There is a capital budget elsewhere here that provides for the maintenance of our existing systems, and we will be using that for a combination of maintenance and development of the system. That's around £9 million.
Sorry, is that new capital funding?
No, that's...
Right, okay, thank you.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
In terms of development, and I think that was touched on there, is allowing farmers to develop one of the aims behind the what would seem to be the policy objective of early payments or getting money into farmers' accounts early? And how does that represent a departure from policy elsewhere in the UK, and if so, is there a budget implication for that? How is that planned?
Well, with the payment strategy that we've had for the coming year, again, these were changes that we knew that had been a call from the industry, and I think particularly over the course of the past couple of years, really seeing the cost of living crisis hit and ensuring that money was reaching bank accounts as soon as it possibly could. Now, I do think the UK government brought forward their initial payment schedule over the course of the last year. We've brought forward our own payment schedule to, I think, that we are paying farmers at the earliest ever stage, and we've done the same with other schemes such as the LFAS funding as well, knowing how important having that money coming through at an early stage as possible is.
Thank you. Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Convener. There's no doubt that right across the entire UK we're seeing budgets being squeezed. I've already mentioned the 37% cut in support for hill farmers down south. And we have environmental targets that we're trying to reach. The AICS budget has taken a hit. So what do you see being the impact of that, and what impact will it have on meeting the objectives that the Scottish Government have?
I mean, AICS is a very important fund for us, and I think out of all the funds that we have, it's the one that we know really delivers against the objectives within it in terms of funding the climate mitigation and the nature enhancement activities that we want to see as well. It's also one of the key mechanisms that we have for increasing the amount of land that we have farmed organically as well, and it has been very successful in that regard. We have in previous years either had to restrict certain rounds or restrict the things that we are looking to fund within that because of the various financial constraints that we faced. So within the current budget that we have against the AICS allocation for this year, and of course remembering that AICS are essentially rolling contracts year on year, so just over, I think, £16 million of the budget this year will go on the previous year's contracts that have been agreed, which means that we have, and the remainder of the budget that we have for AICS, I believe, means that we're in a position where we should be able to finance the vast majority of applications that we've had come through to AICS this year as well. But I would say that AICS isn't the only funding mechanism that we have that can help deliver on the climate and biodiversity enhancements that we want to see. Of course, we have greening, we have the Nature Restoration Fund, which of course doesn't sit within this portfolio, but within the NZ portfolio as well. We have the Farm Advisory Service. So we do have a number of other certain pots that still contribute to the overall objectives, even though they don't sit within that AICS umbrella.
Okay. Are you noticing, or do you have any evidence of farmer changing behaviour as a result of AICS not being in place?
Well, the AICS funding is in place.
Let me rephrase that. If AICS isn't there, do you anticipate or do you see farmer behaviour changing as a result of that?
Well, I would think if the AICS scheme wasn't there, it just means that I think a lot of the activities we would like to be able to see wouldn't be able to take place, or farmers and crofters may not be in a position to undertake certain activities if the funding didn't exist for that to happen. So I think that's why it is such an important fund.
That you have just said that you've got the funding that you think for the claims that you've got coming in this year.
Yes, so for the application for the 2023 round, so we're still to announce the outcome of that, and obviously we've been going through the budget discussions at the moment, but through the funding that we have allocated in the budget, as I say, the vast majority of the applications that we've seen come through the 2023 round, we would expect to be able to be funded.
Just kind of highlights the difficulties that you're facing in order to try and juggle all these things to make sure that the priorities are kept in place. I don't have anything else on this. You want me to go on to the...
Can I bring in Ariane for a supplementary?
Thanks, Commissioner. Just a quick sup on AICS. So from what I understand, AICS is going to get phased out and a new scheme will come in place. Is that correct?
Well, it will continue until such point we have the future tiers of the framework in place as well.
In terms of that, the new scheme, when it replaces it, will you... So AICS has been... from talking to farmers, I find that AICS is quite a tricky one to actually get the funding for. I've heard farmers that make almost all the points but miss it by a few. And when you're talking about how we urgently need to get farmers to move in towards climate and biodiversity mitigation, and then you have a fund that is difficult for them to get to, they miss it by a couple of points. Will the new scheme take that on board and make it more user-friendly to apply to? Because my sense is that we really need to kind of open the floodgates for farmers to really get on board with these schemes.
Oh, absolutely, and make it as easy as possible. I think it's within everybody's best interest. We don't want it to be a bureaucratic exercise, and I think for the types of activities that we see through AICS, we want to make any future support as easy as possible for farmers to access. And again, it's within all our best interests as we do that. So I know that the committee are scrutinising the bill at the moment, and of course we'll be in close communication with the committee, and there will be that scrutiny process of the secondary legislation that we would be bringing forward, which would of course contain the detail of what any future scheme would look like as well. So AICS may not exist in the same form it is now going forward, but certainly we want to see the types of activities that we're undertaking as part of that more fully embedded within a future framework of support.
Thanks.
Just before we move on to a question from Jim, research has shown in the US that doubling down on research and development funding would reduce greenhouse gas emissions, raise outputs and curb the need for land use change, and reduce crop and livestock prices. So there's been a reduction in research and development, or research and analysis, I think, is the budget line. What consideration did you give to increasing that, given the climate emergency and the need to go further and faster?
I think, as with a number of the budget lines that we're looking at, I think there are a number of areas, to be honest, I would have liked to have seen an increase in. But again, with the overall capital envelope that we've got, and the funding envelope is how best to prioritise within that as well. So I think we have tried to minimise any reductions in those areas as far as we possibly can. But I think it's also important to highlight that, yes, we have the overall research programme, where we've had a broad envelope of about £50 million a year to try and support. But we do also support schemes that are really trying to encourage that research and innovation piece as well, for whether that's farmers directly. So when you look at the Knowledge Transfer and Innovation Fund as well, that's one that we've managed to maintain the funding for going forward this year. And again, we want to see the uptake of these funds and really see that innovation, that research support, and of course that peer-to-peer learning as well, which I think is really important.
OK, thank you. Jim Fairley.
OK, thanks, Convener. The Business Development Budget, which gave rise to the Food Processing Market and Cooperation Grant Scheme. What progress has been made in reviewing that scheme, and what are the plans for it in the future?
Yes, I think when I appeared at the committee last year in relation to the FPMC, I mean, obviously we were extremely disappointed at that stage to not be able to run the scheme over the course of the last financial year, because we know how valued it has been by the food and drink sector as a whole. But we utilised that time to undertake a review of the scheme, as you've outlined. That work was undertaken by Scotland Food and Drink. That work is now completed. There were a number of recommendations in relation to that. I think one of the key findings that came out of that report was just exactly as I've said, just how valued the scheme was by those who had applied to it. A few recommendations are recommendations that we would be able to implement quite readily. There are a couple of recommendations within the report from Scotland Food and Drink that would take a bit more work. So we've taken all that on board. Now, the business development support line, as you've outlined in the budget, that was the line where we funded the FPMC grant previously. The funding that's available within that budget line now is for the Crofting Agricultural Grant Scheme. So that's where the biggest reduction in that has been. But it would be the intention, if we are able to at any point over the course of the year, to reintroduce the FPMC grant scheme. That's something that we would like to do if that opportunity arises, but we're not in a position today to be able to say that that is something that we'll definitely be able to fund.
Okay, one of the... I'm all right to continue, Convener? Yeah? One of that food processing market and cooperation grant scheme, I think, is a vital one. And I'm reading stuff just now about Jeremy Clarkson, who's not somebody I would normally be quoting, but he's talking about his diddly squat farm. They're making zero profit, and there are protests right across Europe because of supply chain issues. So this seems to me the kind of scheme that we want to keep on encouraging, as we have done over years. So I just ask the Cabinet Secretary to have that in mind as we go forward. But there's one other scheme that was funded that I'd like to ask you about. It's the Small Farm Grant Scheme to allow farmers to make improvements. I think it was cut in 2022. Has that money been used elsewhere?
Yeah, I think, first of all, just coming back to your first point about the importance of the FPMC, I absolutely agree with you, and I've visited a number of businesses who've received funding from that in the past, where investment wouldn't have been possible to either upgrade facilities in a number of different ways. They wouldn't have been able to develop their business without that injection of funding that we provided. So I think it has been vital in that regard. So we will be looking for any available opportunity to restore that funding as a priority going forward. In relation to the Small Farm Grant Scheme, That is one that we've undertaken a great deal of work on. It was one of the only funds, I'm sure George will correct me if I'm wrong on this, that I think it was one of the funds that we had that was actually the most difficult to access, which meant that it was largely underspent. I think we had £1 million budgeted against that. In the past, it was a means-tested fund, and given that it was to support small farmers, it was one of the things that was hardest to access. So what we did was quite an extensive piece of work with a variety of different stakeholders, and that's where I announced, it was over the Christmas recess there, that we would be launching a small producers pilot fund in place of that. So the funding that had been used previously for the small farm grant scheme will now be getting utilised for the small producers pilot. So there's some projects within that, and again, this has been through that engagement with different stakeholders as to the best support and what would be most useful for them going forward and in helping our small producers. There's a couple of abattoir projects that will be funded within that. There'd been calls for a website to, for small producers as well, and also looking at specific packages that could be used, I think, in relation to skills and further development as well. So there are a number of different strands within that. But I do think that that is potentially a really exciting bit of work and where we can really better utilise that funding in the way that people would like to see going forward.
I've got a particular interest in this tiny wee fact you've just mentioned, abattoirs. What does that look like? What is it? What do you think it's going to shape out like? Because small abattoirs in, you know, real rural communities is a big,
yes,
big issue.
Yes. I mean, the FPMC in the past has provided quite a lot of support for abattoirs, large and small. This particular scheme and the pilot project. Many members, I'm sure, will be aware of the difficulty that farmers, crofters wanting to get private kill done have in engaging with the abattoir. So this is trying to create a better mechanism to work between, you know, the number of, you know, farmers, crofters that might have, you know, one or two animals that they're wanting to take to the abattoir, and how that fits in with the abattoir's own sort of scheduling of kill, to see if we can actually get a system that works better for all concerned, so that will then allow, you know, that private kill to happen, and, you know, the farmers and crofters get better value for their product. So early days, but we have enthusiasm from the abattoirs and the potential users of the system.
And if I could just add, I mean, the abattoir piece of that work was quite substantial, and there'd been surveys and a number of other pieces of work undertaken, because I think, you know, certainly when I go to specific events, whether that's smallholders festivals or again visiting different farms across the country, I think the abattoir provision is certainly one of the foremost issues that comes out every single time. So I think that was a key focus of that work in developing the Small Producers Pilot Fund, a key focus of that, and why we've had that recommendation come out and why we're supporting that within it. So I'm quite excited about the potential of this support and what that can do.
Okay, thank you. Thank
you. Question from Kate Forbes.
It was to go back to a point that the Cabinet Secretary has already made in terms of the £15 million that has been returned. And it's encouraging to hear that is now as capital. Just to clarify, I'm assuming that the way that's already split in the budget will remain as it's split. You talked about it funding unfunded priorities in terms of agri-transformation, crofting grants and so on. Beyond it being changed to capital, will there be any other changes to the budget in terms of the split?
No, I don't believe so. But I'm happy to follow up with the committee in writing and to provide the information as to exactly how that £15 million has been split and where the changes within the budget lines would be, if that would be helpful.
That would be great. Thank you very much. And just one other point, that's obviously £15 million out of the reported £61 million, if I'm right in understanding that. Is there any understanding from the government when the remainder might be returned, or is that subject to future budgets?
Yes, I'll be having those discussions with the Deputy First Minister. So you're absolutely right. The £15 million is part of the £61 million deferred funding, which has been returned to the portfolio and which we've had the agreement to switch to capital funding as well. So that still means that we have £46 million outstanding. The Deputy First Minister has confirmed that this will be returned to the portfolio. But in terms of the sequencing of that and how that can be utilised, that's still subject to further discussion.
Thank you very much.
I'm happy to keep the committee updated on that.
Bill Hamilton.
Can I also ask where that is reflected in the Scottish budget lines that I am looking at right now in terms of that return to the portfolio?
Well, again, that's where, as I've just outlined in my response to Kate Forbes there, I can show there will be changes within the budget lines that have been set out there in terms of the overall switch. It doesn't change the envelope because we'd had the £15 million confirmed at the time the budget was published. So, but it was there as resource funding rather than capital. But that's what was outlined as Kate Forbes. I can outline exactly in which budget lines you would expect to see changes.
So does that come under adjustments? The adjustment line, where does it,
no.
Where will it sit ultimately? Because for a layman looking at this Scottish budget, I can't see where, if you've already allocated it, that you reallocate it, where it sits. Can you just give me an indication of where you think it will sit?
Okay. The £15 million is in the budget at the moment, but you know, if you look, for instance, at the tables in the published budget document, they don't, in the tables, distinguish between resource and capital. But below, there is an off-which capital. So what we will see is that the capital line there will increase by £15 million. But you know, some of that money, for example, is £3.6 million is an AICS. So it's already reflected in the top of the table, under the AICS line, but that will now be capital rather
than
resource.
So can I be clear that in 2024, AICS money from 29.6 will reduce by half and it will be moved into the capital,
no.
Which is 13.8?
No, the 29.6 will remain the same,
right?
But the 13.8 that's down below will increase.
Right.
Because those figures at the bottom about fiscal resource, non-cash capital are within the figures higher up.
Okay. So does that mean that when we go back to the budget in the chamber, that the AICS funding or that part of that supports the AICS funding, you will reflect that there is a further cut to AICS funding? You're taking it out of there and putting it into capital.
No, there is no further cut to the AICS funding.
What if it is resource AICS funding and not capital AICS funding?
Well, it's all AICS funding. So the AICS line is the AICS line. It's a mix of resource and capital.
Why are you going to... So you're going to put it in both lines? Because if you move it to the... If you move £15 million to the capital funding under level 3 of the Scottish budget to 13.8 and you add the £15 million, you take it off the AICS funding of £29.6 million... What to a layman, does that not look as though you're shifting funding, but you're not necessarily spending it on AICS?
Sorry, with respect, and the tables are complicated, but I think this is a misunderstanding of how the tables are set out. So if you look at the level 3 table, you'll see there's 15 or so lines, followed by a total agricultural support and related. The lines that are above that, and let's take agri-environment measure as the example. That's showing 29.6 million. That 29.6 is itself a combination of resource and capital. What you have below the line that says total agricultural support and related are a set of lines headed up with off which then break that down into resource, non-cash, capital, financial transactions. So that's a further analysis of what's above. So the change that we will have will be that the capital at the bottom will increase by, let's say, 15 million. The agri-environment measures line up above will not change because it's already got both the resource and the capital in. We will work with our colleagues in central finance as to how this then appears in the budget bill documentation. The change, as the Cabinet Secretary explained in her opening remarks, has taken place just in the last couple of days. We were anticipating it, but couldn't confirm it at the time of the budget documentation. But we put the money that we hoped to change from resource to capital into the right lines in the budget. So it's less of a change than it might otherwise have been.
So in a nutshell, the 29.6 million allocated in 2024-2025 to the agri-environment measures will still remain the same, but one half will be capital and one half will be resource.
There will be more now, yes, as capital than previously.
Right. And so where in the budget, the total budget, the total Scottish budget, is the other money that is to be returned of that 61 million? Where is that reflected?
The 46 million is still to be returned.
Yeah.
So that would be in future years' budgets.
Okay. Where do I see that in other? Where is it gone?
Sorry,
it's not a waste of time, Ariane. It is really important because this money, 61 million, has been removed from the budget in 2024-25, and that is why this committee is here to scrutinise it. So apologies for picking you up on that, but it is important.
Sorry, it's just to clarify. So £61 million hasn't been, when you're talking about the deferred funding, that's not a saving from 24-25. That was from 22-23 and 23-24. So if you remember back to when John Swinney was the finance secretary and he made the emergency budget review, that was where there was £33 million announced at that time, which were savings that had been taken. And then we'd had the announcement from the Deputy First Minister, I think it was perhaps in November this year, where she talked about the savings and the path to balance that we had to reach this year. So that's £61 million in savings is what we are waiting to be returned to the portfolio. £15 million of that is being returned this year, but that leaves £46 million, which, as I was saying in my response to Kate Forbes, is still subject. It's been confirmed it is coming back to the portfolio, but the sequencing of that and when that happens is still to be discussed with the Deputy First Minister.
Okay, and just the last question briefly on this. Where did the Scottish Government find the money to pay £3.2 million fine from the EU over cap payments, and how will it pay for the remaining £2.3 million should a dispute resolution be unsuccessful?
Again, I think the fine that had been paid initially had come from our budgets, as far as I'm aware. I don't know if George or Karen would have the information as to specifically where that had come from. Karen?
The fines had been accrued for in prior financial years, so under normal accounting convention, there's been no finding of money now. They were accounted for at the time that the penalties were incurred.
From the agricultural budget?
From the appropriate budgets, which...
£0.2 million has come out of the rural affairs budget to pay for a fine.
It would have been at the time that we had the EU income coming back as well. So there has been no reduction from the 23-24 or the 24-25 budgets to meet this. They were accounted for in the period that they were brought to our attention.
Okay, I'm running out of time, so I'll leave it there.
I've got a supplementary from Alistair Allen and Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, convener. It's been briefly touched on, but you won't be surprised to hear me mention crofting. And I just wondered how many of the budget lines are seeking to meet the government's objectives on crofting, or can you say more about those aims, please?
Yes, I'd be happy to. So I think, as I touched on in my response to Jim Fairley's question about the business development support within that as well, so that's where we've seen the remainder of that budget is for the crofting agricultural grant scheme. We also are continuing with the crofting housing grants as well, which I believe falls under the crofting assistance budget line there too. I know how important these budgets are for some of the most rural parts of Scotland, particularly for our island communities as well. And that's why we have obviously made that a priority within the budget to ensure that we're still continuing to maintain that as well. The Crofting Agricultural Grant Scheme is a demand-led project, and I think we have about 900 applications to that every year. So, of course, ensuring that we're continuing that support going forward was really critical. But I think also alongside that too, we have the funding for the Crofting Commission, which I think we've been able to maintain a similar level as to the previous financial year. Again, I think that funding has been really critical in terms of the maintenance, so that we're seeing that continued improvement. I think when it comes to the Crofting Commission and what they're the work that they're enabling there and that they've been taking forward. So, of course, all of that, I think that support in its entirety is vital for our island communities.
Thank you.
Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. And I just want to thank the Cabinet Secretary for going over again in great detail about the £61 million removed from the agricultural budget in 2021 to 2023. My question is, despite the overall cut in the rural affairs budget, there was a 5.2% increase in the community-led local development budget due to anticipated demand. And I'd be interested to hear what the thinking is as to where that money will be applied, and also if regional land use partnerships will feature in that, given that they're doing such important landscape scale work.
Just to highlight, first of all, I think that I completely understand your point about the importance of the rural land use partnerships, and you'll be aware that we've got a number already established across Scotland. I've been looking at how the development of the land use partnerships has been going. That does fall under a different budget line within the budget as it's presented, and falls under the land reform element of that as well. And I think we funded that up to, I think it's around £400,000 a year in relation to the RLUPs themselves. So, of course, they're continuing on at the moment, but we, of course, want to carefully evaluate how they've been performing so far to determine then how we potentially take that work forward. You've mentioned the community-led local development and the funding that we have available to get to that. Again, I'm going to provide the committee of the breakdown of how the £15 million and where that's been allocated. Some of that has been allocated to the community-led local development within that to ensure that we have a capital element of funding in there too. That's funded really vital work across the country, and of course is the legacy to the leader scheme that we had previously, which is about that development in our rural and island areas. We have the local action groups across Scotland who are the delivery bodies in relation to that. If I look to my own constituency, we have the Angus Rural Partnership as well. They've become a charity to enable them to really drive forward work on the basis of the funding that they receive there. I know how critical that is for our local areas, for our rural communities in particular, which again is why we've prioritised that within the budget as well, and ensuring that there is funding there going forward.
Thanks, Convener.
I've got a supplementary from Beatrice Wishart.
It's actually a supplementary on Alistair Allen's supplementary about the CAGS, the Capital Agricultural Scheme. A local crofter indicated to me that there's been no increase in the threshold of £25,000, and I just wondered if that was something that might be under consideration.
If there are particular concerns that are being raised with you, I'm more than happy to look into that. It's not a concern that I've had raised directly with me. You'll be aware that the Minister for Energy and Environment has responsibility for crofting, and I don't know if that's an issue that's been raised with her. I mean, as with anything and with some of the crofting schemes that we have, we do look to make improvements where we possibly can. So I think if you look to the Crofting House Grant as an example of that, where we have increased the grant rate there, and we've also looked at introducing measures for energy efficiency too that didn't exist previously. So I think if there are adjustments we can make within that, or that's something that we need to look at, then I'm more than happy to follow that up with the Minister for Energy and Environment and consider that further.
Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary, Stuart Goodall from Confor has congratulated the government for its increased woodland creation targets. But over the last 5 years, the amount of trees created has fallen. We're now looking at a massive cut of over 32 million in its grant budget, which means that it'll only, in the words of Stuart Goodall, it will only serve to make the gap between targets and delivery even wider, a bad situation becoming worse. And goes on to say that a cut of the scale proposed will lead to job losses in struggling rural areas, destruction of millions of young trees, and a blow to the sector's confidence that will take a long time to recover. How on earth, with such a massive cut in its budget, will Scottish Government be able to meet its forestry ambitions?
Well, in relation to the targets that we have within the climate change plan, that had been due to increase to 18,000 hectares of planting this year. And that's the thing, and to be perfectly frank with the committee, with the levels of funding that we've got, that's a target that we are unable to meet, which is particularly disappointing. I completely understand the comments of Stuart Goodall and how frustrating this is for the forestry sector. And I think especially at a time over the course of the past year, we hadn't met our planting targets last year. I'd held a woodland, a forestry summit, towards the end of last year as well, to really look at what some of the issues were in terms of reaching the targets, what were some of the barriers and the challenges that the sector was coming up against. We also made a number of different changes to the forestry grant scheme, and we'd increased rates to try and encourage more agroforestry and to see more trees on farm. So obviously to be in this position and be in front of you today with the level of cuts that we're looking at for forestry isn't a place where I want to be, and certainly not what the forestry sector wants to see as well. I understand exactly, just as I've said and outlined, the Stuart Goodall's comments in relation to that. And I think what's really important now is the work that we do from here. I think the forestry summit that we had was valuable in a lot of ways, and it's how we can really look to work within the budget available that we have. It would ultimately enable us to plant roughly the same level that we've planted, or just slightly above the level that we've planted this year. So it's really how we can best utilise that funding. But again, when it comes to the overall capital funding across the piece, it's if we were to put more funding into that, it's what areas of capital would we cut and put in its place. And it has meant that these really difficult decisions have had to be taken. And again, certainly not a position that I want to be here in and discussing with the committee today.
Yeah, Alistair Seaman from the Woodland Trust has suggested that creating new woodland and protecting what we've already got is one of the simplest and most effective responses we have to climate and the nature crisis. And we hear on almost a daily basis your colleague, Mary McCallan, talking about the crisis, the emergency we face. So surely you're getting your priorities wrong by such a massive cut in the budget for woodland creation.
But again, it comes back to, if we were to fully increase that budget, then where do we take the capital from? I mean, as we've talked about today, each of these funds that we have is vital in its own area. I would say that I agree with the comments that you've just mentioned there. And that's where, I mean, when you look at the investment that we're making in the Atlantic rainforest as well, where I think it's around £4.5 million this year, and that's exactly to do that work. It's about looking at the resource, managing invasive species that we have there too, and best protecting that resource. We have done an absolute power of work in relation to forestry, and I think when you look at how the industry has grown, we're still responsible on the whole. I think it was around 62% of all planting within the UK last year. We want to ensure that we do still build that confidence in the sector and that future for it going forward. But there is no getting around it. It is a big cut to the capital budget that we've seen, and we have £27 million available for new planting this year. But we have to ensure now that we utilise that as best we can and ensure that we're getting those trees in the ground.
OK, thank you. Kate Forbes.
Thanks very much. It's more just a general point at the moment as to whether the Cabinet Secretary is content that we are on track to meet planting targets. I'm conscious that at the end of the day, all the debate about budget is really about whether we can achieve our aims and ambitions. And our planting target is one area where the government has very ambitious targets, which we require to meet.
We have very ambitious targets, but as I was just outlining there, the capital that we have available for new planting isn't sufficient to enable us to meet the targets that we have set out for the coming year. So the targets within the climate change plan right now and what we would be have been hoping to try and reach this year would have been 18,000 hectares of new planting. So with the current capital budget that we have, it doesn't enable us to do that.
Thanks. We now move on to a question from Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. In last year's budget, the Marine Directorate received a £14 million increase in its budget allocation, and Cabinet Secretary, you indicated at the time that the extra funding was to increase capacity to deal with the government's ambitions for offshore wind and its ambitions in relation to highly protected marine areas. But given that HPMAs have been abandoned, how will the funding be redistributed? The funding that was allocated to HPMAs, how will that be redistributed?
Well, I think when you look at part of the budget reduction in relation to the Marine Director, that is partly due to the fact that we're not proceeding with the HPMA proposals. So, but what we have done, of course, is best utilise that funding on the priorities that we are taking forward. So when you look at marine protection as a whole, of course, it's my colleague, Mary McCallan, who leads on the policy for HPMAs and the marine environment. But a priority remains for us still delivering on the fisheries management measures for the MPA network and the priority marine features as well. And that is no small exercise in and of itself. We have about 160 different sites where we would be looking to implement measures. So, of course, that's going to mean that we have extensive stakeholder consultation as part of that process. So, again, that's where the funding that we have in relation to the marine environment is now being prioritised and ensuring that we're looking to deliver these measures and previous commitments that we've made in that regard. But I don't know if Dave would have any more to add in relation to that.
No, just to agree with the Cabinet Secretary that the funding is for marine protection as a whole, and HPMA is one option, but we are still taking forward the protection of the marine protected areas and the priority marine features.
Thank you.
That. When do you expect that consultation to start and what form it will take? Because there's, I guess, a lot of rebuilding of relationships that needs to take place to make sure that everyone is happy and on board with some processes going forward.
Yes, you're absolutely right. And I think this has been quite a long, ongoing process, as it's been anyway. I know that there's also, proposals in relation to the offshore MPAs as well as the inshore MPAs and priority marine features. But I believe that the consultation, I'm sure Dave will correct me if I'm wrong, is due to commence towards the end of this year. I think that's the current timescales that are being worked to.
And Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. The budget documents state that the Marine Directorate is delivering savings through recruitment controls, by maximising income streams, and by achieving greater operational efficiencies. I'd be interested to hear what is meant by maximising income streams in this context.
In relation to the different income streams that the Marine Directorate has, there's commercial science, I think that brings in over £3 million. There's marine licensing fees. I think there's another one that I'm missing there as well, Dave, but I'll hand over to Dave, he'll be able to give a bit more detail about the extent and the levels of funding that we receive through that and how that will be. I think some of those areas in particular will be growing in the future with, of course, offshore wind developments.
Yeah, yes, the Cabinet Secretary is right. We generate income through commercial science using our facilities in Aberdeen, and we receive licensing fees and energy consenting fees is the third category. Obviously, that the licensing fees and the consenting fees create demand, so it's more of a cost-neutral situation where we are using that income to meet the demand for the consenting and the licensing.
Thanks for that. And could you say a bit more about the recruitment controls and also achieving greater operational efficiencies in the directorate.
Again, I know that Dave will have more detail in relation to that as well. I think it's fair to say there's been a fair amount of transformation within the Marine Directorate and really focusing on this and reducing those costs where possible.
Yeah, one of the main indicators is the number of staff in the Marine Directorate. That's gone from 825 full-time equivalent in December 22 to 760 in December 23. So that's a fall of about 10, I think, between 5 and 10% through restructuring, bearing down on kind of staff costs. That's been also matched by looking for ways to be more efficient. On the compliance side, we're looking at maximising the use of our assets, our marine protection vessels. We're using more intelligence-led and risk-based approaches to that compliance and just trying to get the most value for money that we can.
Okay, Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask about marine directorates and firstly, what's the support for science? Sorry, not marine directorates, I beg your pardon. About science and enforcement, and what's the support for science and enforcement in the budget, and what changes have you had to make?
In relation to that, in the science and enforcement, and I think in previous either communications and appearances that I've had at the committee, I think the last time I was here, we spoke about at that time what was the science and innovation strategy, which just launched last week in Aberdeen, actually. So that really just sets out how we are going to be, well, it's our science and innovation strategy and sets out six outcomes within that we want, how we're best going to focus our resource on science going forward and to really maximise the value of that resource too. We have a world-leading marine science within the Marine Directorate. And I think we need to ensure that we're utilising that resource as best we can. And a big part of that is about how we can collaborate with other, whether that's research institutions, academic institutions as well, and looking at that more widely within Scotland, how we can better collaborate on the pieces of work that we're doing, as well as looking internationally too. But of course, in terms of the overall funding within the directorate for when you look at marine science, we have around, I think it's £9 million on when you look at the science around fisheries. And the vast majority of that funding, I think, is about £6.5 million, is for the two research vessels that we have as part of that work as well. Of course, another critical part of the Marine Directorate is the compliance and enforcement work that takes place too. So we have, I think it's 18 coastal offices, two surveillance aeroplanes, we have the three MPVs, as well as two RIBs that we can utilise as a resource too. In terms of the overall budget for enforcement and compliance, that's around £30 million, of which just over £11 million is for the MPVs that we have too. So that investment that we have, I think, has stayed broadly similar to what it has been over the course of the previous financial year.
On the subject of the major vessels that the Marine Directorate has, the research vessels, is there an element of spend to save required here for the future, or are you making plans for how those vessels might have to be replaced in the future or maintained?
Of course, I mean, like anything and like other vessels, they do have an overall lifespan. So, of course, that is something that we have to factor into our planning going forward. And it's because they are very specific vessels as well, when you look at the Scotia, which is one of our key research vessels. So we've got to ensure that we have these resources going forward. And, of course, that does form part of our planning for the future too.
Thank you.
Rhoda Grant.
Thank you. Can I just ask a quick supplementary on that? And something I've been involved in for many years is the pay settlements for Marine Scotland mariners. They are significantly lower paid than other mariners employed through the public purse. And I'm wondering what impact this will have on a pay settlement for them.
I'll have to ask Dave if he has any further information in relation to that.
I don't have any further information in relation to that. What I can say is that the pay negotiations for the marine staff are part of the same negotiation processes for the Scottish Government.
Pay to follow up with you specifically or provide the committee with further information in relation to that.
Okay, thank you.
To ask your next question.
Yes, thank you, convener. Can you give us the reasons why there is a 50% cut in harbour grants and how this will impact on harbours, both for fishing because of storm damage, but also because most of those harbours are multi-purpose, that will have also an impact on infrastructure with regard to ferries and with regard to renewables?
Absolutely. As we've already outlined in quite a lot of detail today, just the significant capital pressures that we're facing, but also to highlight in relation to that fund. So, as an example, and it can highly vary from year to year, of course, depending on some of the storms and weather events that we've seen as well. So, if you were to look over the course of the last year, we had spent only £84,000 within that overall envelope of £1 million of funding. And it is also highly variable where we can see, and depending where those storms are, the ports and harbours we have on the east coast tend to be more exposed than those on the west. So we believe with the funding that we have available, hopefully that will enable us, should there be any other events, that we can utilise that. But again, it can be a variable fund. It has been reduced because of the pressures that we're facing, but again, because of the fact that it had been so underspent over the course of the past financial year. But I think this is one that we will have to continue to monitor closely.
Can I just... I'm aware of, for instance, Wick Harbour needs substantial investment, and that would have been coming out of this current financial year. If there's an underspend, did you look to making that available to the harbour?
I think I would need to follow up with that one directly so I can look into the circumstances, and I'm not able to say right now if there has been any communication between ourselves and or what involvement there has been, unless, Dave, you have any more information on that.
I can definitely follow up on Wick Harbour. We're anticipating a spend of about £900,000 this year. Some of that is as a direct result of Storm Babbitt, which obviously was an East Coast storm predominantly. We're not anticipating a big underspend this year because obviously we've been working with some of the harbours on the emergency repairs from November onwards.
So you'll be pleased to hear we're moving on to the final few questions, and the first from Alistair Allen.
Thank you, convener. I was going to ask firstly, about the islands programme and the funding for it. Obviously, it's welcome that despite the capital climate, there is capital spend in there, but can you say more about the budget lines and how they're being utilised, please, in that area for the islands programme?
Yes, I'd be happy to. So I can understand that the committee would be disappointed that it looks like it's a cut on the previous year, which, of course, the funding is lower. But what I would say as a whole, I think when I last appeared in front of the committee, when you look at the capital spending review and the overall allocations, there hadn't been anything against the island programme. So that's where, in spite of the really difficult financial circumstances that we're in, and particularly with our capital budget, that I am delighted that we're able to continue with the islands programme for the coming year, as well as provide that vital funding for the carbon neutral islands as part of that. In relation to the overall islands funding then, so what that means is we have £1.5 million which has been allocated to the resource funding for the islands programme, and we have £3 million which has been allocated for the capital element of that. But we also have within that the carbon neutral islands, and we have £0.9 million against the resource funding for that, and £1.3 million. So if you're taking those two programmes as a whole, there's an overall envelope there of £6.7 million of funding for the coming financial year.
Are there any budgets out with that are relevant to the aims the government has on islands that that you can say anything about where they stand budget-wise this year?
Oh, absolutely. Well, I would say that, well, even within my own broader portfolio, if we look at spending that's going to be relevant, you know, you'd asked me a question earlier about crofting, which is of course vital and I think really important spend for our island communities. We have the funding of the island's growth deal, which of course is developing and delivering some really important projects. When you look at the wider spend across the piece, obviously, I come to a committee every year where we talk about the National Islands Plan, which is ultimately showcasing how every portfolio is delivering and what they are, outlining what they are delivering for the islands and against the strategic objectives that have been set out in the Islands Plan as well. So that's where I think it's not just the funding immediately through the Islands Programme, which is relevant here, but also the various different funds that we're taking through, whether that's housing, when you look at health, education, all these different areas, there's spending there that will have an impact on our islands and that is relevant for that too.
Point. Obviously, and you expect me to point this out as well, islands have very distinctive needs. But are we getting nearer a point where, if you like, an understanding of that fact is being mainstreamed across departments?
I don't know if Erica would want to come in on that. I mean, I do think, and I think I've said this previously to the committee, I think the fact that we have an islands team who do work extensively across and with other portfolios across government has been really critical in helping to develop and further that understanding. So it's something that is inbuilt to decisions that are taken in different portfolios, and there is that engagement right from the outset. But I don't know if there's anything further you want to add on that, Erica.
Not a great deal, Dr. Ryan, but thank you for the question. I think I've answered something similar before at this committee, and we do work extraordinarily hard to try and make sure that island needs are recognised right across Scottish Government, and the whole team are very committed to doing that. And we have, through the legislation, the added benefit of having island communities impact assessments, so we have a tool that we can go out to other areas across SG and make sure that they're considering island needs and those unique island needs that you just highlighted there. There's different needs in the work that they're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. When the island bond policy was shelved, we were assured that the £5 million would stay within the Scottish Government budget to deal with depopulation. So could you tell us where that occurs within the budget and indeed what other specific monies are being set aside to deal with the depopulation in our islands?
Well, I think just to clarify in relation to that point, I know that that had been an ask of the committee, but at that time when I think we were considering that policy, there wasn't a £5 million budget allocation within the budget for that year for that to be developed, because obviously we were undertaking the initial work undertaking that engagement on the island's bond. So initially there had been a £300,000 allocation within the budget for the island's bond policy. So of course with the extensive engagement that we'd undertaken, we heard quite loud and clearly that this wasn't something the island communities wanted to move forward. That's where we utilised the funding that had been available in the budget at that point to deliver on the practical policy test, which I think I've talked about previously in the committee before, and that was based on the outcome of the engagement that had taken place on the islands and based on ideas that people thought would help tackle issues such as depopulation and could help assist with that. So within that, I think we had about, 11 different projects that had been underway as part of that work. I think one of those that I discussed previously in committee was in relation to a piece of work that had been undertaken with, well, and the biggest part of that funding, I think it was about £250,000, was work that had been undertaken with SDS, with Highlands and Islands Enterprise, as well as different local authorities on a skills and population pilot. So I think that the work on the evaluation, I'm sure Erica could come in with more information, but I think the work on the evaluation of that is still to take place and will be underway. But that took part in three different local authority areas and really looking at bespoke solutions that could be created around skills. But I don't know, Erica, if you have further information you can add on those projects.
Just really a little bit more detail. The three areas were Argonne and Bute, North Ayrshire and Western Isles, and we worked really closely with the partners that the Cabinet Secretary has already outlined there in her answer to kind of make sure that that project was a success. We intend to evaluate that in the coming financial year, subject to Cabinet Secretary's approval, and that will allow us to consider the impact of that work and whether there's any value in rolling out to further areas.
Okay, so what you're telling us is the £5 million that was set aside for the Islands Bond is no longer going to be in the budget to address depopulation, but that hadn't been a commitment or...
Well, the £5 million was an overall figure that would have been used for Islands Bonds had they progressed, but it hadn't been £5 million within that budget, purely because of... Well, in developing the policy, we had to go through the engagement exercises. And of course, as we've seen and as we've talked about before, we're in an annual cycle of budget processing. So, of course, we'd be looking at these decisions. If we proceeded with that policy and decided that was something we were going to pursue, then, of course, the budget and the priorities within it, as you're seeing it today, probably would have been different. But, of course, it was decided that we wouldn't be moving forward with that policy. That's why we undertook the work on the different tests, which are then helping inform what interventions are going to be best to address depopulation going forward. Of course, we're still waiting on the publication of the Addressing Depopulation Action Plan, which is being led by the Social Justice Portfolio. I'm responsible for the Rural and Islands element within that plan, and we do hope we're in a position to be able to publish that shortly. But that's where it's been important for us to, first of all, listen to that engagement, undertake this work, which will be helping inform the actions that we have as part of that plan going forward, so we know that the interventions that we make to address depopulation are going to be meaningful and have the impact that I think we all want to see.
OK. Can I ask why it's been delayed, the Addressing Depopulation Action Plan?
I think, again, it's about, well, ultimately making sure that we get the Addressing Depopulation Action Plan right and that it's in as strong as a place that it can be, and ensuring that we've got the right actions within that. But, of course, I'm happy to write to the committee and keep you updated on the timescales and when that's eventually published. But, again, I do hope that's going to be shortly.
Okay. And with regard to the 250,000 looking at employment and retention on islands, is there something similar in the budget this year? We are very aware of island businesses really struggling because of ferry unreliability, and what monies is there to encourage those businesses to stay on island?
Again, I think in specifically relation to that, as Erica had mentioned, we're still to undertake the evaluation of that project in particular. But I think it's where the funding of other elements that we've undertaken has been really important. We've had the community resettlement officers that have, you know, positions that we've helped to fund as part of that work. And also the funding in relation to the Addressing Depopulation Action Plan isn't just coming from this portfolio or interventions from this portfolio. I think there's a further commitment from the Social Justice portfolio as well in relation to funding for that too. But again, that's all part of the considerations and what we're looking at as part of the Addressing Depopulation Action Plan.
Okay, so how can we measure that as regards the budget? How can we measure the amount of money being invested in repopulation?
I think overall in the National Islands Plan and the report that we can do on that, because addressing depopulation, of course, doesn't just come down to one specific intervention we take. It's right across portfolios, what we're doing in housing, what we're doing in skills and all these different areas, and in transport as well. So it's right across that that you will see that spend. Ultimately, I think a lot of that is what we will try and capture within the Addressing Depopulation Action Plan, and that will set out the different actions that we're taking across government to help and try address some of these challenges. So I'm afraid I don't have a straightforward answer to it, because it is something that ultimately all portfolios within government have to work together. And that's why on the Population Task Force, we have representation from, I think, the vast majority of portfolios across government, because it's within everyone's interest and we all have a part to play in delivering on that too. But of course, I think the detail of that will be in the document that we publish.
And Burgess.
Is this question 15?
No, it was a supplementary on...
Rhoda got it.
Okay, thank you. Cabinet Secretary, could you perhaps give us a little bit more information about what the £1.5 million revenue funding element of the Island Plan budget is?
Well, I think obviously because we've been undertaking the work on the budget, and again, we've been looking at what we'd be able to fund in relation to capital, we're still to finalise and we'll still have those discussions about how that resource funding could best be utilised. In previous financial years, of course, we've had the Islands Cost Crisis Emergency Fund, where it's helped contribute to that as well. But we'll obviously be having those discussions, you know, with our with local authority partners as well, to see how best we can utilise that going forward.
Okay, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. This is on carbon neutral islands, and given the significance of the project for Scotland's net zero ambitions, I'd be interested to hear about the thinking behind the reductions in the budget from last year to this year, and also having met with some of the amazing young development officers, I can see how important those roles are and also the challenges of the one-year funding cycles. And I had a conversation with one of them that doesn't see it's not sustainable for them because they're making major life considerations and they're not sure if they're going to be employed. So I think it's really important that we're clear with those people doing those amazing projects, incredible work, what the future is going to be for them.
Absolutely right, and I can completely understand why they would feel like that and being in that position. Unfortunately, we do go through these annual budget processes, but I would say that you're absolutely right in terms of how vital their role has been. I think that the project is being successful and hope will continue to be successful, but a lot of that, well, it is all down to the fact of the groundwork that the community development officers have put into making it a success and ensuring that we do have that real, true community engagement happening on the ground and the buy-in to the process as well. So we will be continuing to fund that going forward, and again, absolutely recognise how important their role and their job is within that. So as much security as I can look to provide to them, I'll absolutely strive to do that. I would say within the budget as it's set out, there is a fall in the resource funding. Part of the reason in relation to that is that there hasn't been as much requirement for resource funding given the stage at which the project is at. So all the carbon audits for the islands have been completed, the community climate change action plans have been published, and some projects are in the middle of being delivered as well. So the key focus in the next stage in that programme was about the investment strategies going forward and how we can look to, you know, leverage and make the most of other sources of funding within that. So that's going to be the real critical piece of work. But I think one good thing about the funding that we have available this year is that we do have a slight increase in the capital funding that's available too. So I hope that will be of benefit to the overall project. But I think it has been one thing that is proving to be successful. We have seen really develop, again, down to the work of the community development officers. So we want to make sure we're seeing that continue, because I think it really gives us such a good platform. And also, it's, I think, one thing that we're considering now, I don't know if Erica would want to add anything to that as well, is about how we can share the learning. I think that's been a critical part of the project from the start, is it's not just for these six islands themselves. It's how we can share that thinking and share the progress with other islands, as well as looking internationally on that point too.
Just agree with absolutely with all of that, but just to maybe offer you some reassurance around the development officers, that my team are working on a one-to-one basis with them very, very frequently to just try and give them as much certainty as we can around the funding cycles and future funding, because we do recognise very much that they are central and at the heart of this project. And just to pick up on the Cabinet Secretary's final point there and her response, in terms of the rollout, the further rollout of the project, we're now going to be moving into a phase where we're working with our partners to understand the best way to do that and to try and find the most pragmatic way to share the learning. And that's going to be a target for the project this coming financial year.
Thank you.
Thank you. And our final question from Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. My concern is around Highlands and Islands Enterprise budget. We see another large cut this year, following on year-on-year cuts over the last decade. Given the state of the economy and the need to repopulate and encourage population retention in the Highlands and Islands, what impact is this going to have?
Again, I don't have the exact information in relation to the high budget. It's not an area that falls within this portfolio, so I'd be happy to follow up with more information in relation to that. But again, I think it's important, you know, as I've said with other parts of the budget too, and particularly in relation to our islands, I think High undertake a really important job, which is really valued. There are partners in a number of pieces of work, and I think I've touched on some of that today. But we can't look at each of these things in isolation. It's about how we're working across the piece. It's not down to one agency or to one portfolio to deliver for our islands and assure we're addressing the challenges there. It takes that cross-government working and that cross-government approach to delivering on that. But again, I'm sorry, I don't have the specific details in relation to that, but I'm more than happy to follow up afterwards.
Do you have concerns about it, given the impact it'll have on your area of responsibility, islands, land reform, social and economic impact of fishing, farming and traditional industries as well? It all makes High less able to act and build on those economic drivers.
Oh, I absolutely have concerns about that. I think I'd probably come back to the comment I made right at the very start. I'm not sitting here happy with the budget settlement that I've got, and ideally I would love to be able to fund some of these more areas or plough more funding into that. The fact is we have got the envelope that we have. There are similar challenges right across government, and I know that none of these decisions are easy decisions to take at the moment. So, of course, it does concern me. It concerns me some of the cuts that I've seen within my own capital budget as well. But ultimately, we have to try and find a way to work within the envelopes that we have. For High, that will be no different. So, of course, I'll work with them, work with Neil Gray, the Economy Secretary, as well, to see how we can best work together going forward and make sure that we're still maximising the positive impact that we can have on rural and island areas.
Thank you. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes our evidence session for today. Thank you very much for your attendance and that of your officials. I'll now to spend the meeting until 11:30.